In this problem, we're given two different masses compressed together against a stiff spring, and we're going to release these masses from rest on a smooth level surface so they spring apart. And of course, what we're trying to find here is their final velocities. And I actually want to take two different approaches to this problem. First, I think it's appropriate for trigonometry-based physics students, and that would include high school physics and life science-based physics, to just go ahead and plug in numbers early in this problem because it simplifies the algebra a lot. And then for engineering students and physical science majors, I'm going to do a complete symbolic solution of the problem and then plug numbers in at the end. So the algebra is a lot more intense that way, but when we view the symbolic solutions, we're able to see symmetries in the solution that we wouldn't see otherwise. So I do want to point out here that the one piece of information that's not in the diagram is this 10.5 centimeter initial compression distance of our 220 newton per meter spring. Now all the other information is in the diagram. We have a small block with a mass of 2.8 kilograms and a large block with a mass of 5.5 kilograms. And again, the spring constant is 220 newtons per meter. So the way it's written, we're kind of guided through the solution here. In part A, we want to write down the equations expressing conservation of momentum and energy. So in our initial state, we don't have anything moving at all, which means our initial momentum is zero. So if we start by writing down conservation of momentum, P initial equals P final. Remember, momentum is a vector. Our initial momentum is zero. So I'm going to write that as the zero vector. And then our final momentum is the sum of a leftward momentum and a rightward momentum, and we keep track of those with plus and minus signs. So just writing this symbolically for now, my little mass, I'm going to call that M1, is moving to the left. So that has a momentum of negative M1 V1, where V1 is the speed of that mass. In other words, V1 is a positive number, and I took care of the direction already with the minus sign. My second mass moves in the positive direction, so I have a plus M2 V2, and this gives us a nice equation, M1 V1 equals M2 V2. Now, I do think it's fine to just start with that equation. If you know the momentum is zero in the initial state, then you know the magnitude of the leftward momentum, that's M1 V1, must be equal to the magnitude of the rightward momentum, M2 V2. Okay, secondly, we look at energy conservation, so E initial is equal to E final. And in the initial state, the energy is all stored in the spring, so I can write that as a 1/2 kx squared, where x is the initial compression distance of the spring. And then in the final state, I have two objects moving. Each of them has kinetic energy. So 1/2 mv1 squared for the kinetic energy of the smaller mass, and then a 1/2 m2 v2 squared for the kinetic energy of the larger mass. And we can clear all the fractions out of this, just multiply both sides by 2, and we get a little simpler equation. So that's kx squared equals m1 v1 squared plus m2 v2 squared. Now in part B, we're asked to solve this system of equations for v1 and v2. And again, what I'm advocating here for high school physics students and life science physics students is just go ahead and put the numbers in early because it makes the algebra a lot easier. So my first equation becomes 2.8 v1 equals 5.5 v2. In my second equation, I have k times x squared, where x is the initial compression distance. I'm going to go ahead and compute that. So that's 220 times 0.105 squared, and that's going to be equal to 2.8 v1 squared plus 5.5 v2 squared. So then the whole approach to the solution here is to use substitution. So I can solve for one of these v's in terms of the other. It doesn't matter which one. I'm going to go ahead and solve for v1. In terms of V2. So I just divide both sides by 2.8, and this gives me V1 is about 1.964 V2. Then we sub that in to the second equation, which then gives us an equation where the only unknown is V2. So as I'm writing down that second equation, I'll go ahead and simplify the 220 times 0.105 squared. That gives me about 2.4255. And then on the right-hand side, I have a 2.8 times V1 squared, but V1 is 1.964 V2, at least approximately. And then I have another term with a V2 squared in it. That's 5.5 V2 squared. So when I'm cleaning up the right-hand side, I have a V squared in both terms, and I'm going to factor that out. Then the numbers I have in this first term are 2.8 times 1.964 squared. So that gives me about 10.8. There's actually a couple zeros after that. In my second term, a 5.5 v2 squared, and we're factoring the v2 squared out of that. So now I can go ahead and solve for v2. I just take my 2.4255 and divide by the sum of 10.800 and 5.5, and then I square root the result. And this gives me an answer for v2 of 0.386 meters per second. Now all I have to do is take that v2 and plug into our relationship here between v1 and v2. So v1 is 1.964 times v2, and when I run the numbers on this to three significant digits, I get 0.758 meters per second. Again, I think that's a fine way to solve the problem in a trigonometry-based physics class. But for my engineering students, I would expect a complete symbolic solution before we plug the numbers in. We always get a little more insight into a problem if we solve it in a general form first. So let's go ahead and start from these equations. M1 V1 is equal to M2 V2. That was the result of conservation of momentum. And then kx squared is m1 v1 squared plus m2 v2 squared. And that was the result of applying conservation of energy, where we just cancel the factor of 2. Now our solution strategy to this system of equations is going to be the same. We're going to solve the first equation for one of the velocities and sub into the second equation and then solve for that remaining velocity. And we can go ahead and solve for v1 again, but now we have to keep it symbolically as m2 divided by m1. Times v2. Then we sub that in to the second equation. So when I square v1, I'm going to get an m2 squared over m1 squared, v2 squared. Notice that one of the m1s cancels here. And also notice that v2 squared is common to both terms, so I'm going to factor that out. So in my first term, I have an m2 squared over m1, and in my second term, I just have an m2. Now it's going to be useful to get a common denominator here, so I'm going to multiply the m2 by m1 over m1, and that allows me to add these two fractions. So the first one had a numerator of m2 squared, and the second fraction, because I multiplied by m1 over m1, has a numerator of m1 m2, and our common denominator was m1. So I can rewrite that right-hand side by pulling a factor of m2 out of the numerator and pulling out that whole denominator, m1, and writing this as m2 over m1 times the quantity m2 plus m1. Now again, the goal is to solve for v2 here, so I need to multiply both sides by the reciprocal of this coefficient, and that gives me on the left-hand side an m1 kx squared over m2 times the sum of the two masses. I'm just going to write those in the order m1 plus m2. Seems a little more natural, and that's all equal to v2 squared. So now we can solve for v2. So v2 is just the square root of all this stuff. So I have m1 kx squared over m2 times the sum of the two masses, m1 plus m2. So then we can go back and find v1. So we just use this original substitution up here. V1 is just m2 over m1 times v2. But if I distribute the m2 and m1 inside that square root, it becomes an m2 squared over m1 squared. So maybe I'll just indicate that by putting a square root on this guy and noting that the original m2 over m1 can be thought of as the square root of m2 squared over m1 squared. So now one of the m2s is going to cancel, one of the m1s is going to cancel. And what we see is a beautiful symmetry in our two equations. The answer for v1 is going to be m2 kx squared over m1 times the quantity m1 plus m2. In other words, we find the second velocity by simply swapping the roles of m1 and m2 in the final symbolic solution. Now we can go ahead and plug in numbers into these formulas. M1 is 2.8, m2 is 5.5, k is 220, the initial compression is 0.105 because we had to change it to meters. And when I run the numbers on this to three significant digits, I get all the same results. V1 is going to come out to about 0.758 meters per second. That's the smaller mass that's moving faster at the end of the process. And V2 is going to come out to 0.386 meters per second. That's the larger mass moving slower at the end of the process. Maybe just a final note on this result. We expect the larger mass to be moving slower at the end of the process because both of these masses had to be feeling the same force for the entire expansion of the spring. And of course, the smaller mass accelerates more quickly than the larger mass. so it comes out of this explosion moving faster. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.